In this video, we're going to talk about the prevailing wage determination for your H-2B visa application. We're going to dive into the when, the where, and the what.
After the break, we'll see you back here. Welcome to Law Great. This is the channel where we give you lots of H-2B visa information and typically give you information to help you make better decisions and avoid costly mistakes on your immigration journey as either an immigrant or an employer looking to hire immigrants from abroad. We're talking about the H-2B visa process for April 21, April 2022. If you've been on YouTube for any amount of time and been looking for H-2Bs, first of all, you're a little bit weird. But second of all, you've probably seen our videos from 2018, which tend to be at the top of the rankings for this category. The H-2B visa process has changed a lot since 2018. It's changed quite a bit. COVID has changed it even more. You can check out the video on how things have changed here that Santiago is going to put up. Thank you, Santiago, our amazing editor. Today, we are talking about, in this video rather, we're talking about one small sliver of the H-2B process, which is the prevailing wage. The where?
The when, the where, and the what.
The when, the where, and the what. Prevailing wage, Trent, what's the when?
Well, if you tuned into our last video, we had a big emphasis that the when is now. The when is further in advance than you could ever imagine. So if you're looking for workers in April, the when is now. You want to begin filing your prevailing wage determination in November. Between November 1st, November 15th is sort of
our recommendation.
Right.
You can file afterwards, but it's our recommendation.
Right. It takes about 30 days to get that back. Sometimes more, sometimes less. We're expecting very high demand, probably historical demand for the H-2B visas. So longer than 30 days is likely.
Check out this video for more on why the demand this year is historical.
So file that prevailing wage early November. That's the when. The where? Do you know where?
My mom's basement.
Sure, if your mom has a laptop in the basement and you can access flag.
Can I do it in the attic?
Sure.
On the street, 5G?
Yeah.
Yeah, how?
Go to flag. If you're an employer who's not using an attorney or an agent who's familiar with this program, FLAG is the system that you will use.
Here's FLAG right here. Thanks, Santiago.
So today is October 13th. As we mentioned, you want to file this early November. So you've got a couple of weeks right now before you need to file. Use that time to get familiar with FLAG. FLAG is where you're gonna file the 9141. It's where you're gonna file the next step in the application process and the next step. So really try to familiarize yourself with FLAG.
If you're working with an attorney, you don't need your own FLAG account. We do it all for you. You know, our FLAG accounts are thick with cases. But if you're doing it yourself, your FLAG account will look exactly the same as ours. Okay, so we covered the when. We covered the where, which is FLAG. When is November 1st. But the what, like what are we actually talking about, this prevailing wage? What is it?
The what is
Form
9141. Now, if you're going through FLAG, you will not actually see Form 9141. They have a nice little automated system that you fill out your information. Your information includes company information,
your EIN,
point of contact, you know, just things like that. It's pretty straightforward. What we're going to spend a little time talking about, though, is what's maybe not that straightforward.
Okay. So there's some special issues that we want to be thinking about. Okay. So in the simplest form of prevailing wage, you want one type of worker, okay? You want some number of that type of worker, but there's more complicated scenarios. You want multiple types of workers, okay, for the job that you need done. You file a prevailing wage and it comes back at an amount you're not happy with. So there's special circumstances too that we want to cover, okay? The regular circumstance is you're filing for one type of worker, but the two complications might be you're filing for multiple kinds of workers and you might file for a prevailing wage and see that it came back in very high. So what do you do in those scenarios? And what do you do to avoid a high prevailing wage to begin with? So let's start with normal prevailing wage.
Right, so for a normal prevailing wage, the key part is making sure you are accurately describing what the position is. You know, you don't have to go into a lot of detail. For instance, if you are recruiting a general laborer for a position, you don't have to tell me everything that laborer is going to do day in, day out. you know, hit the hot points and tell me, will perform standard construction general laborer tasks, something of that nature. You don't, again, you don't have to go too specific. And what you do need to go specific on, though, is does this worker need experience? Does this worker need a degree, anything of that nature? You have to really think about the position.
So let's say I want two workers. Let's say I want a general laborer and a mason. What do I do in that circumstance?
Right. So in that circumstance, you're going to want to file two prevailing wages because you're really filing for two different positions. You know, you wouldn't file for masons if the majority of the positions you wanted were general labor, or else you'd have a higher prevailing wage, and you don't want to have someone who's going to perform 90% general labor and 10% mason getting paid 100% mason prevailing wage rate.
That's not economical.
So, again, really think about the position or positions that you need, and then describe those positions. But also be conscious of the fact that if someone does, you know, more skilled labor, they're going to get a higher rate. So if you, you know, if you have masons currently in your permanent workforce who, you know, with the help of general laborers could do more work and complete the jobs, don't file an application for masons, file it for general laborers and keep those two positions very separate.
Okay, so one thing that we see come up, right? An issue that comes up is when you're a bigger employer, not only are you filing for multiple positions, you're filing for multiple locations.
Right, absolutely. So that is the number one thing, you know, describing the job, figuring out which jobs you actually plan to use the visa program for is very important. But I would say the most important and, you know, the highest potential of scrutiny in an audit down the road, you know, the highest potential to trigger a notice of deficiency when filing your 9142 application would be this geographic location of work sites. So if you're a bigger company, like you mentioned, and you're working at, you know, maybe seven different counties, four different states, things of that nature, you really have to describe all of those and go into depth and discuss where these workers are going to be working. Now, it may require that you need to file more than one prevailing wage depending on the distance between those places, but you have to. It is of the utmost importance that you state where your H-2B workers will be working. If you don't, you're setting yourself up for penalties in the future.
Okay, so now, so we've covered this kind of multiple worker special case. What about the special case where maybe I haven't followed some of this advice, maybe I haven't thought about what kind of worker I need, and my prevailing wage comes back too high. Do you have time to file a second prevailing wage?
Oftentimes you should file that second prevailing wage
before you get the first one back, right?
Well, you should file it when you file the first one. So you can, you know, make slight modifications to the job description, you know, things of that nature, just to see what comes back and then make an educated decision. You know, do I actually want foreman? Do I actually want general laborers? Do I want a hybrid of the two positions? You know, what makes sense? What am I gonna have to pay these workers? And is that number acceptable?
It doesn't cost you any money to file a prevailing wage, okay? And you don't have to use all the prevailing wage certifications that come back.
Right.
So filing multiple prevailing wages, as Trent said, to test out the market for each sort of position you think you need, right, is a really smart move. So that's a big veteran tip.
Right, and sort of along that line, state every workplace that the workers may work. Even if
they don't.
Because what you can do is remove locations for the next stage in the application. So if you get a wage back for county one and it's exponentially higher than county two, you might say, you know what? I'm gonna send my permanent workers to county one. H-2B workers are gonna work in county two. That way I don't have to pay that county one prevailing wage rate.
And you explain that in your 9142B.
Well, you just leave it out. You just leave it out.
You just don't even put it in. Yeah, there you go.
And we'll discuss that more in the 9142 video, but essentially, again, know what position you need or positions. You know, maybe think about creating multiple prevailing wages to see what rates come back so you can make an educated decision, and include every geographic location where workers may work.
And you should do, you know, pretty well. If you want help, we're taking clients through November 12th, because the last prevailing wage we want to be filing is November 15th. Our numbers are at the bottom, at the description of this video. Do give us a call. If you like this video and you want more H2B videos, which are all coming out this week, go ahead and subscribe, hit that notification button, comment in the comments if you want us to give you a call back. Okay? We'll see you next time.